15 seconds from now.
Oh, it looks like it's broadcasting.
Oh, there it is.
What's
that
called?
Verse.
A verse.
Cool. All right, y'all. Looks like we're good to start. Actually, let me make this broadcast my screen.
Oh, dang it.
How do you do that again? Sorry, my computer's freezing. Sweet. Cool. Look at that infinite regress. I always love that. Yeah, it's wow. Just keep putting them in there. Okay. That should. Hide this. So this is the second session of my homeschool class. Contemporary Nudity, Building a Better White Supremacy. Can everyone see? Am I in the way for anyone? First, thanks to Kyle and Ellie and for hosting the session in Cheech House, adjacent to the garage exhibition space. Shouts out to the people that paid us. You can't really see Precipice Fund up there. They're the people that are in charge of distributing the money, I guess. You can sort of see it. It's very thin sans serif.
It's a constellation.
Yeah. No, for sure. And endless thanks to Victoria, obviously, my homeschool collaborator and co-founder. And to everyone here and online for watching and taking part in this. So for everyone who either came to or missed the last session, here's a summary of what we discussed. The contemporary positions marginal practitioners in a relation of debt to modernism, analogous to neocolonial governance by financial debt structures. And this is an idea from David Joslet. And this governance by debt serves to erase the aesthetic and political debt that modernism and the contemporary have to global black and brown practices that it treats and treated as raw material. And so in this ostensible debt structure, the debt E, the marketized white art world, conditionally includes the debtors, by which I mean marginal practitioners, to shore up generational wealth and flatten practices, specifically marginalized practices, to accord with this legibility criteria. So that was the last class. Here's a quote from a Himishi Fair video. Didacticism by marginal practitioners is commonly lauded and invited by institutions. Public galleries, come at me bro, come at me sis, commissioning of marginal didacticism is definitely mistaken for institutional critique. However, this misreading correctly positions a ruling majority within the institution. From his video, Marginal Aesthetics, which you can find online. In this session, we'll screen a couple of videos. They're pretty short, about 10 minutes of screening. Please don't interrupt during the screenings. Then I will do a performative lecture during which I do invite you to interrupt. And I will read some poetry press releases, sort of reappropriated press releases that use poetry, and I'm reading them divorced from their context as ways of selling art or making people interested in art. And then after I read those, I'm gonna take a vote, and remind me to take a vote if I forget, because I wrote a new poem and I wanted to gauge people's interest in reading it. Okay. So before I move on, let me screen the work.
Why do I need the state to validate our love? I won't abandon a friend when times get tough. I'm addicted to chapstick. My peppermint chapstick melted. Yes, I left it in my jeans pocket and washed it and put it in the dryer. Now my clothes smell like peppermint chap. Damn, I really love my peppermint chap too. Sigh, it was a love so perfect, so true. I wear makeup only because I want sex and compassion from strangers. I hate outdated software. I work at Best Buy. I found the site by accident. I like writing random thoughts. I'm the father of an 8-year-old drummer who has 1.4 million YouTube views. Do you ever run out of data on a monthly basis and have to stop using your phone? I am a certified Hanasomatic educator that teaches people how to move out of chronic tension and regain flexibility and ease of movement. I cut off all my hair when he left me. I faked pregnancy at my last job to take an extra long vacation. Why am I online? It's not even like the love of my life will message me today. I secretly watch someone jack off. I love the female body. I just got home from donating bone marrow. I love to wear wigs. I love wigs. I love kissing. I own a small home theater business. I have lost a child. Why is there some chick in my seat? I went home with a random guy last night. I'm a Scottish TV development producer in Asia looking for the next best thing. I always say I'm fine. I'm fine. I have CP and Asperger's. Feel free to ask any questions about me. I enjoy Impressionism, Monet. I am fascinated by human behavior. I'm a diapered teen. I'm amazed at how many people were spanked growing up. I'm horrified of friends knowing I get spankings. I'm still spanked by mom. I broke curfew and got spanked. I deserve more spankings than I get. I had my mouth washed out with soap. I had to bring the hairbrush to my mom and she spanked me.
Dan Havas at Art
Should I wear my hair for next year? If you need to both for everyone. I'm just making sure the top isn't. Sometimes I feel very shifty.
Can you stay far away from doing your whole body?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got your whole body in there.
Ready?
I'm all up in the play. Everyone sits and knows my name. Why? I'm a princess. Got a love train as a princess Jasmine. She like a white boy, she a woman hottest. Like a pretty girl, she deserves no way. Love me to get to one tonight. Long head, don't care. We all head girls, we don't give a fuck. Not to be played with, boy, we got like a snapback bitch. Don't know the love though, she's about to get good. Let me girl, then she'll be ratchet hoe. But it ain't this, I'm a princess. So what you wanna do, boo-boo? I'm a princess. So what you wanna do, boo-boo? I'm a princess. Y'all some business, bitch. My team's business, bitch. Y'all some business, bitch. My team's business, yeah.
Babysit this child, a white boy. One day while coloring and drawing, he filled in the character Rhino. He pointed and informed me, "That's you." I babysat this white boy, this child, for a while, on and off. One time, later on, down the line, upon coming home from work and finding us at the table sketching, his mother saw one of his drawings. She pointed at it and asked him, joyously, "Is that Brandon?" The drawing was of a black blob mess.
What do you want to say about her?
Hey, somebody said, fuck you, baby. Oh, you want me in your video? Fuck you, baby. No one's coming to your shows, huh? Fuck you, baby. And then what do you do?
Where?
When you can't pay more than
$1,000,
you can't sell all the singles in store.
I get that money. wife in the backseat of my brand new foreign car. Don't act like you forgot. I call the shot, shot, shot. Like blah, blah, blah. Pay me what you want it. Don't act like you forgot.
I get no money. Bitch, give me what you got. Get no money. I get no money. Bitch, give me what you got. Get the money. I get the money. Bitch, give me what you got. Get the money.
So I'm going to show the names of those four pieces again, just so people can know what they were. Can you all see? I should maybe go over there.
Yeah, there's room on the floor if you want to sit, but also
I can stand here. So language is a value creator in general, which works to subsume experience into various economies, by which I mean that language is a tool for determining what experiences have value and what experiences can be marketized or financialized. And the same goes in art. In various ways, language is a tool of legitimation. And I'm trend forecasting when I say that. The days of quoting post-1968 white European critical theorists like Gilles Deleuze or Philippe Attari, Francière, et cetera, people who have read art press releases or critical market writing know the references, but I think that's dwindling. And the new thing, which is also an old thing, is using poetry in the press release, or fiction, or vernacular language like emails or transcribed conversations in the press release, et cetera. The fetish of poetry within art as object without an outside value causes the false construction, or helps the false construction of interiority, which bolsters the artist as institution. And so the question is, why poetry? Why does art have a crush on poetry now? Why are so many readings happening in galleries? Why are press releases so full of poetry? What is poetry's perceived and actual role in value and value violence? A screenshot from Wikipedia. Sometimes I think about etymology and how like people try to reclaim terms or reclaim contexts by looking at the original etymology of a word, and poetry comes from poiesis, which is apparently a way of reconciling thought with matter and time and person with the world. Okay. David Anton, who is a kind of talk poet, he calls himself, he improvises poetry talks, says that poetry is a commercial that isn't selling anything. But if that's the case, then how is it a commercial? Hashtag deep. As art, you can laugh. As art and art education continue to marketize, by which I mean continue to apply market logic to aesthetics and to aesthetic work, the art world scrambles for whatever available tactics it can find to reconstruct authenticity in order to cover its tracks in terms of its involvement in neoliberalism, coloniality, exclusion, and general mediocrity. Poetry in the press release and in the gallery, and as a part of an artist's practice, allows the performance of exhaustion in relation to value without changing the terms of value or value's violence. And feel free to interrupt my talk at any time. I welcome divergences and tangents. Shouts out Ellie for this tweet. Performative lectures are excuses for white mediocrity. David Joselyn argues that the art market creates dividends resulting from ratios of marginalized heritage to neocolonial financial and aesthetic debt. One dividend that results from this ratio is the magical economy. Debt is forgiven by way of marginal artists operating in this realm, a realm outside of value where magic is the operative, the modus operandi, I guess you could say. And as a staple of magicality, poetry, both on its own and in the press release, stands in not only for this forgiving of debt through the magical economy, but also for legitimating pretend marginality slash poverty porn slash fringe romanticism, etc., from dead ease, people who mobilize the shame of their power to protect and enact that power or build an aesthetic around it, etc. So as I said in the last class, putting on airs of marginality, ally theater, tokenism, etc., are just ways of avoiding resource distribution, which if you're a teleological Marxist, is kind of inevitable, but I'm not. So another Wikipedia screenshot. The archetype of the Poema D is one that I think is something that artists are looking at. They're thinking about this drug addict who wanders the streets and hates the world, but finds beauty in these tiny moments and authenticity and abjection. And poets like Paul Verlaine and Arthur Rimbaud are classic examples of the poet movie. Art fetishizes poetry in two ways, generally. First, by seeing it as a valueless object, as in both operating outside financial value, but also having no financial value. And this lack of value or outside of valueness is what Beeple calls an infinite hermeneutics, by which authentic, non-marketized, or mediated expression can occur. So this idea of, this fetishistic idea of poetry as a kind of ad copy without being ad copy, kind of revelry and abjection, whether it's true or false. And the general use of poetry in art in that fetishistic framework is the use of this kind of post-confessional, like digital Frank O'Hara lyricism, like, oh, I got a martini, and life is really bad. Look at the Greek gods, etc. I'm reading some press releases later as poetry so we can think about whether I'm right or not in characterizing it in that way. And the second fetishistic framework is seeing poetry as, to quote Roman Jakobson, organized violence committed on ordinary speech. And this is not only a formalist rejection of material conditions, as in the reality of the world. It bears an uncanny resemblance to how art institutions and institutionality in general are forms of organized violence committed on ordinary people, both within and outside of the institution. And so this fetishistic framework is a kind of sublimation of politicality and magicality. And here's an ad from, I think, London. It sort of reminds me of a sentence that I would find in a poetic press release. Press releases are ads, but this is an actual ad. And I'm thinking about the use of abject and violent poetic language to sell this dating service. It's interesting. If I saw this in person, I would freak out, probably. So poetry, as Anson said, may be a commercial that doesn't sell anything, whatever that means, but it certainly is being used, at least in part, to sell art and increase interest in it, hashtag deep. Baudrillard says, you can't pretend to rob a bank. Conversely, I say, you can't pretend not to rob a bank. White devil archetypes, fetishizing failure, coping by trolling, avoiding causality, soft criticality, manic pixie school shootings, cupcake fascism, fairy bread politics, silicon feudalism, vaporwave ethics, cuckold aesthetics, lean in poetics. Hashtag deep. This is a scan of Beeple's book from 2011, The Uprising on Poetry and Finance. And the blurb of the book up here says, poetry is the language of non-exchangeability, the return of infinite hermeneutics, and the return of the sensuous body of language. I'm talking about poetry here as an excess of language, a hidden resource, which enables us to shift from one paradigm to another. No. This is a quote from the book. Digital financial capitalism has created a closed reality which cannot be overcome with the techniques of politics, of conscious, organized, voluntary action, and of government. Only an act of language can give us the ability to see and to create a new human condition where we now only see barbarianism and violence. See, I was pretty sure, I would say 100% sure that before I read this book, white and white indoctrinated people giving away their stolen resources and divesting from whiteness was the first step to overcoming, but apparently not. It's an act of language. Language is revolutionary. Beeple does not go on to describe this act. Instead, he sort of diverges and talks about a classical distinction between irony and cynicism. The book later ends as follows. The ironist sleeps happily because nothing can awake her from her dreams. The cynicist sleeps a light sleep, he dreams nightmares, and he gets up as soon as power calls him. I mean, look, what is the pronoun thing going on there? Like, what? It seems really misogynistic to say that women can't enact power and violence. Like, that's ridiculous, but whatever. Eh! yeah, language is revolutionary. In a satirical jab at press releases attempted legitimation of mediocrity, John Russell, going under the moniker Bank, faxed galleries, corrected and scored press releases in 1999. Unironically, this critique acts as a platform to legitimate his own mediocre work. He seems aware of this and plays with it to varying degrees of success. He also wrote and had others write serialized sci-fi for use as press releases. He was not correcting or rating any press releases with poetry, so this is an open question. Maybe you all can do that in your spare time. I tried to do it, but I don't have a printer, so I couldn't print it out. And like, because he did handwritten notes, which I think is a nice aesthetic. So here's one of them. The score is 2.25 out of 10. And it has both like very banal critiques, like make this smaller, but then it also has like, I mean, this one doesn't have as many, but for example, this one. I haven't seen this piece of work, and this sounds ridiculous. Like, I don't know. I just think it's funny, but also, maybe. Okay. Is the press release in its language really so critical, or am I treating a symptom like a cause? And here's a scan from Art Forum in 2008. Now back to the mother of it all, the beating heart of the enterprise, the exhibition's brain trust, the press release, the works here. Truly, the press release is a symptom. It doesn't have as direct a role in art's violence as money laundering, neocolonialism, and weaponizing of aesthetic mediocrity. But press releases still operate as nodes in an affective and aesthetic economy. They are not only illustrative of the conditions of art, but also catalytic within them. And there were some essays, one big essay, and then a bunch of responses to it that came out a couple years ago, critiquing this sort of, I guess, highfalutin post-1968 quoting press release style, where people talked about like the relational aesthetics of sweeping dust into a corner to discuss or to interrogate, you know, capitalist precarity, whatever. You know, here's a Rancière quote, so you know it's real. Mm-hmm. But things are changing now. People aren't using that language as much. And so the critiques of that essay kind of make me think of what has changed. Like, what has changed since these people stated that poetry was the antithesis of the press release, that poetry was this gateway to authenticity. And here are a couple of quotes. In 2014, Monica De La Torre said in the Harriet blog on Poetry Foundation, an increasing number of announcements, however, are being written by artists who seem to deliberately want them to be read as poetry. These idiosyncratic texts move associatively and through unexpected semantic juxtapositions and leaps, plus a more or less convincing performance of artistic temperament. They, at least theoretically, thwart the very purpose of press releases. A form of institutional critique, perhaps. They refuse to ventriloquize the pseudo-critical marketing template that prevails in most communications of the kind, press releases, and provide artists with yet another stage on which to rehearse the roles of high capitalism's renegades. Poetry in the press release. Which is which? Are they fighting? Are they friends? Like capitalism, this is a quote from Quinn Latimer in the Free Summer 2014 issue. It was the introductory article to the magazine called Art Hearts Poetry. Like capitalism, contemporary art is hungry and omnivorous. It devours and assimilates everything. Poetry embodies the need to use language in a way that is not useful in the conventional sense. Perhaps artists are tired of use value, or perhaps conversely, art's turn toward poetry is about poetry anxiously attempting to join the market. I mean, it could be both. It doesn't have to be one or the other. And then a quote from Xian Nai. I forget where this is from. I just have it in a text file. Poetry's, quote, powerlessness in commodity society can be reconfigured as its distinctive ability to theorize powerlessness in general. These quotes provide useful food for thought, but don't question the assumption, both within and outside of art, that poetry's uselessness or existence outside value provides any kind of authenticity. However materially true it may be that poetry has no value, And realistically, there probably isn't that much money in poetry going through or changing hands compared to art. But however true that may be, conceptually it is false. Poetry as press release is certainly institutional critique in the sense of a brand, like Andrea Frazier turning the Whitney into a prison because she found out how bad prisons are. I'm certain money changed hands, but I'm unsure any prison reform work got funded. Who is your audience? Poetry seems useless. This is text that I wrote to contextualize the first homeschool poetry reading. And in that series of readings, we always work with people that whose practices are in a slippage between art and poetry. And so poetry seems useless. Global white supremacy continues killing black and brown people. Like most exoticism, art's crush on poetry emerges from escapism. The fantasy of poetry as refuge, a circumvention of the demands of value, free of the white cube. The truth, the poetic expression, is the securitization of the individual, the lyric empire, unless it comes from the mouth of whoever cannot speak. That's rhetorical because the subaltern can't speak. Is that the shadow of poetry? But it would be silly to ask what comes after poetry. Is that sillier than asking what comes after whiteness? Poetry, as institutionality, generates a managerial relation to phenomena, a proper subset of how whiteness does. And that's sort of a callback to the idea of poetry as, and language in general, as a way of deciding which experiences have value. White artist starter pack. This quote sort of provides a better approach, but has its own problems. And it's from an article by Tracy Jean Rosenthal. She was writing about two things, responding to the international art English essay, as well as the move away from that style of language to the use of poetry in press releases. But she was also reviewing a book of poetry that came out to accompany the new museum triennial, which is called Surround Audience, I believe. And the quote is, "Perhaps visual artists are tired of their own uselessness. Perhaps poetry seems like a strange, immediate, handy field of action, more easily disseminated through contemporary channels, more honestly reckoning with its limitations as a form. The fantasy of poetry as a refuge, the impression that poetry circumvents the demands of art, is condescending at best, and a facile deception at worst. Like most exoticism, art's crush on poetry is founded on a fascination, not with an escape from, but rather a return to the real." And for me, the idea that poetry is a return to the real is itself escapism. Mm-hmm. And another quote from Quinn Latimer, which sort of avoids all of these theoretical discussions and talks about why actually on a material level it might be useful to use art, poetry and art. And she says, "Art's turn toward poetry is about the new linguistic currency of the internet, advertorial, adolescent, content-driven, anxiety-ridden, always appeasing, liking, performing, sharing, driving the shares up." This is a quote from someone on Facebook. "Unsure which is more counter-revolutionary, sincere pseudo-intellectual rejection of antagonism or post-ironic antagonism as lifestyle brand? Arguing for a magical economy," which is what the use of poetry and art does, "to replace the financial economy, which is art's superstructure, is an attempt at absolution," also escapism. "It is a way of lashing back against the recent decreases in art's opacity," whether we're talking about the Panama Papers, the confirmation of the CIA's involvement in abstract expressionism, et cetera. And it reminds me of the supernatural FBI procedurals I've been watching, like Fringe, Limitless, Blind Spot, Quantico, some other stuff, where magicality and randomness do a lot of work to humanize the violence of state agents. So this idea of, like, quote, "it's out of our control, it's not supposed to make sense," et cetera. And the paradigm I'm talking about implicates project spaces, et cetera, as well. The points I'm making aren't reducible simply to context where vast sums of money change hands, but in all contexts of aesthetic value creation, whether or not they're using poetry to do that. In the face of increased precarization, governance by debt, and the erotics of anxiety, artists find ways to continue embodying institutionality. Here are some screen caps from Fringe, from the show Fringe's intros. Definitely my favorite. So, to take a usefully reductive stance, in whiteness and its prehistory, poetry went from a copy of a copy of a copy, banned from Plato's Republic, to a facet of imperial Christian religiosity, to unacknowledged legislation during industrialization, as Shelley says, poets are the unacknowledged legislators of the world, to a formalist subsumption of primitivity, orality, slash embodiment, such as in modernism, beat poetry, to a metaphor for being outside of value and power, such as the 70s Marxist language poets, or art's contemporary crush on poetry. All of these forms are forms of revelry within mediation, as opposed to the ostensibly unmediated experience and quote unquote, return to the sensuous body of language, as Beppo says, that poetry may be said to reflect. Erger poetry. Paul Mann said in The Theory, Death of the Avant-Garde, The Theory, hyphen, Death of the Avant-Garde, the dematerialization of the art object is the refetishization of discourse. Conversely, the rematerialization of art, exemplified in the recent poetic returns to abject figuration, nostalgic maker aesthetics, obscurantism, and poetry's incursion into art, is the dematerialization of discourse. The language of the new left, faux marginality, ally theater, quote unquote, check my privilege, I'm good now, right? Tone policing, et cetera, is the result. And these are all ways of performing a sense of exhaustion in relation to value, a sense of fake powerlessness, by which I mean that if you don't want the unequal structure of the art market to change, you change your methods of protecting it and deputizing yourself in its favor. The discourse. It's a spicy discourse. Are you afraid of the discourse? Or are you refetishizing it? Or are you rematerializing it? Or dematerializing it? Hashtag deep.
Hey, Manny, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I was wondering, especially within the last slide, not the, the discourse slide, but the text slide, like how the implicit, like the...
This slide?
Yeah. How the use of like poetics, specifically within press releases, like is seen within that like dematerialization of the discourse. Especially because, like, I don't think that there's, it doesn't, it, there never really feels like there's discourse ever around the press release statement.
Right.
So, like, they themselves feel like a dematerialization of that, too. But then also, like, the dematerialization of the discourse through, like, poetic usage, too. And I'm just sort of interested in, like, in what you might think about that.
Well, I think that everyone has a different idea of what poetry is, but I think a lot of it has to do with poetry as a way of authentically transcribing one's embodied experience in the world,
yeah,
regardless of whatever formal techniques are chosen to do that, because, you know, there have been many throughout history, and in this context specifically throughout white poetic history. But this idea that poetry has something to do with authenticity, or that it provides some sort of street cred, or that poetry in itself is dematerialized,
yeah,
because it transcribes things that you can't, you know, recreate. I mean, sensory experience is so singular. Like, that's it. When it happens, it's gone. As it happens, it's already gone, right?
Yeah.
And so poetry has this idea of like, or it promotes this idea in its use in certain contexts of like returning to the dematerial, returning to the pure affect, to pure aesthetics, right?
Yeah.
To an escape from material conditions and politicality and teleology, etc. And so that's one of the ways. I think another of the ways has to do with like, poetry doesn't need to explain itself, right? It just is a language act, somehow embodied. And so when it's used in art, it's a way of like essentially saying, I don't have to explain myself.
Do you feel like it's like, so you think it's like a, it negates like anyone's ability to interrogate the press release?
You saw me because I'm trying to do that. So hard to say.
Yeah.
No, of course not. It's just a way of performing exhaustion toward the sets of language that have been used before to whatever extent the press release creates value, there's been a set of discourses used to do that. And people are being like, no, fuck that. The language is annoying, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I just find it such an interesting point to like be imposing something that like is weaponized towards like producing street cred or like,
right,
realness towards
something. But also censoring white feelings.
Exactly. And
yeah,
that is like then imposing it upon like something that is so inherently unreal and like a product itself of like unreal marketing strategies,
right,
and like these sort of things, like the identity of the press release is so like uninterrogated, in as much as like it's been completely conflated with the notion of having even an artist statement.
Yeah.
It's like that's it's like one and the same, you know? Yeah, I don't know.
It's not interrogated, but it's also always in crisis, right?
Yeah, it's like
because art's relationship to value is crisis. It's like, oh, we don't know what to do. I'm like, accelerationism. All right. Is there anything else? So, equity versus equality. The largest swath of press releases incorporating poetry that I've encountered deploy a sort of digital post-confessional lyric. Much of it is doggerel, which is defined down there, two definitions. Comic verse composed in irregular rhythm, as in without meter, or verse, or and or verse or words that are badly written or expressed, as in, quote unquote, the last stanza deteriorates into doggerel. This is a poetry term that Ron Silverman in the 1970s, or that was his biggest period, 1970-80, that he popularized through his blog, which is like this beacon in the ocean for contemporary white poetry. And it's something that I religiously checked from ages like 14 to 18. It's definitely a valuable resource. He just has really questionable opinions. So much of it is doggerel, and the de-skilled nature of the language points toward the word's labor of humanization and the performance of authenticity. This use of language seems to attempt to frame the work itself as being somehow outside value in its violence or exhausted in relation to it. Do you feel that this is too reductive? How can poetry be an escape from value, an absolution of your relationship to power, if poetry itself enacts power against the powerless every day? Both in institutions and local scenes, poetry skews heavily white and favors men, and even a cursory glance at where poetry institutions get their money or the violent actions of lauded poets in the past year. I'll provide a number of examples here. If you want me to explain them? People know, right? Those examples indicate how absurd the idea that incorporating poetry into art is at all any sort of material shift in the art world or divestment of whiteness within it. So poetry and art, standing in for exhaustion with respect to value, is nonsensical because white poetry itself is exhausted of outsider attacks, quote unquote, on its notions of value. Quits art for chess, like Duchamp. Quits art to lift weights, like Nick Cosmos. Richie Edwards invented ally theater. Yoni Wolf invented activism. David Foster Wallace invented All Lives Matter. Ada Lovelace invented computation. Detroit invented vaporwave, not her fault. Fuck it, I'm just gonna say it. John Lennon deserved to die for walking like this. Make America Pay Operations. Thank you. So we can have a convo or we can just chill, we can do whatever we want. Stop screen sharing.
A thought that like popped into my head, which is it came when you were mentioned the thing about like, is this too reductive?
Right.
And I guess it was interesting to me because when I, some like press releases that I've seen that seem to me, like seem to be copying like a poetic style or as poetry, I always feel at least, and this is like incredibly reductive, that it's attempt to be like weirder or say the weirdest things possible just to be interesting. Like I never really thought that much more about it.
And I think that's true in poetry proper and in press releases that use poetry.
Yeah. Like,
because you don't have to explain yourself when you're writing poetry, you can just go all out, right?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Oh, right, I'm supposed to read some press releases. Right, but does anyone have any questions before I read the press releases that I chose? Give me a second. If you have questions now, or you can ask questions after I read these.
Yeah, actually, Manny.
Jamie?
So, when you just, can you talk about exhaustion? So
yeah.
In the context that you're using it? I understand it as like
being tired.
So, yeah, but the performance, so the way that you're saying that press releases of using poetry to perform exhaustion.
Exhaustion.
Yeah. to like performing
Sorry.
Exhaustion of that exhaustion of like the language of press releases, of art press releases,
mm-hmm.
that like the performance of that's hackneyed or that is exhausted. Like, can you just explain?
I just meant that when people use poetry as press releases, they're performing an exhaustion toward value as a regime,
mm-hmm.
but also, like you're saying, toward previous discourses in press releases that created or informed value.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. It's interesting that is like a, see, that's kind of figured as like a necessary precursor for reinvesting, like, reinvesting press releases with life.
Right, with authenticity
yeah,
and with like real aesthetics.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Or something.
Cool, thanks.
Excellent.
I'm not that familiar with the current like trends in press releases, but would you say that there are like any other techniques that people are using to perform that exhaustion other than poetry?
Definitely, yeah, that's an interesting question. I mean, we can talk about like what the work itself would look like when that exhaustion is being performed, right? And I had this slide about this nostalgic return to like craft aesthetics within art, you know, people who are, or abject figuration as well, like bad painting of, you know, figures. This idea of marginality as being cool, as being something that you can evince in the work and also reflect in the press release, right? And so, I don't know, I mean, I guess if you don't care or know about contemporary art, it's hard to think of an example that might resonate with you.
You mean just like generally performances of exhaustion?
I'm thinking of like, what kind of, like, if I say David Rapinoe,
mm-hmm.
in terms of abject figuration, I don't know if Jackson, if they know them, or like, examples don't matter.
Yeah.
That's my opinion, is that there definitely are many ways of doing it. And there's this huge return to abject craft, basically, to like purposefully badly crafted work, right? But or if it's not actually badly crafted, it looks that way. It looks precarious and it looks like it's a metaphor for capitalism or something, you know?
Yeah.
I wish I had an example I could think of. I guess I could show examples too. I turned the projector off, but.
I guess
I'll send you a list of things later. I mean, how about that? Things that are both like that I like and that also exemplify what I'm talking about. Because why would I send you bad stuff to look at?
Great. Thank you.
I guess I would actually probably like to read that list too. But I'm just curious: is there anyone explicitly claiming that this shift in language towards the poetic is like more authentic? Or
The quotes are saying they're critical of it, but they're still assuming poetry has no value. That's the central assumption.
Okay. I mean,
right.
Yeah.
And then I'm sort of bristling against, and I'm saying no, poetry itself as institution and local practice is really invested in protecting its value. Right.
Do you think it's a thing where like when presenting poetry in that context, it's sort of this idea that like I'm using poetry because I'm doing this. To me, it always seems to come from this place of like low effort and not owing the audience anything. Yeah, and like, I don't owe the audience anything, so I'm gonna do this thing that took no value from me, so I'm giving you nothing, no labor, no effort, no time, yes.
That's
and,
exactly why I quit at Bifo, because
he's
part of that automatist, like, you know, operaismo movement of like Italian rights to laziness and workerist, I guess you could call it subversion of capitalist labor practices, right?
Yeah.
I don't know if it is or isn't, but that's what they call it. And the idea of laziness as a right that people have.
Yeah.
Right. But then I was looking into like the etymology of this, right? And like, who invented the right to laziness? Paul Lafarge, right? What did Paul Lafarge say? Laziness in classical Greece was abhorred by the leisure class. It's workers for slaves. It's like, oh, okay, good, now I understand. The right to laziness is because there's someone else is doing the work.
Yeah.
Right. You don't hate work, you hate the worker. I get it. And so the reason that I quoted Bifo was because he's straddling this line. He's both a huge stalwart reference for the sort of language that is still used in post-1960 mm-hmm. critical theorists, but he's also on the precipice and saying, like, no, poetry is this revolutionary force, right? And so it almost feels like a natural transition, like people quoting these ridiculous European Maoists who are, like, basically fascist, essentially.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
came up with a set of discourses that were useful to selling art.
Yeah.
But some of them, like Bifo or, you know, Maurizio Lazzarato, et cetera, are
yeah.
talking about a shift toward revolutionary language acts, and,
yeah.
et cetera. So it's interesting to think about how there is a genealogy there and how there is a, like, people are moving toward and probably will be
yeah.
moving toward, like, presenting laziness as having inherent value.
Yeah.
As having inherent resistance qualities. Right?
Well, people do. Like, there's definitely
yeah,
a whole political movement just based around the, like, but like, I hate my job political movement.
And I'm
just is like,
do a Facebook update.
Yeah, and like,
but they pay me for that.
No, totally. And like,
right.
I like measure my own personal worth and how little I do my job. Like, I feel like that is like a political movement that at least I see.
For sure.
Yeah.
And I see a version of that in art, for sure.
Yeah.
Not only within this return to abject craft aesthetics, but also like, in any act where, you know, the gesture is really minimal. The gesture
yeah.
is like, it seems to evince a lack of thought. And I struggle with this a lot too, because my work is very like, right?
Yeah.
But that's I,
really
what I like to do.
Yeah. I was going to say, it always looks amazing on Instagram.
Oh my God. That's like the, when Brian Droitcourt critique post internet art because it preened itself with the camera and didn't activate space. Like, I don't want to activate space. What space? But yeah, any questions? I can read now some press releases. Can someone pass me a session?
Anyone else would like somebody on four?
Thank you for that. I think that was mine. So I chose a couple of press releases. Some of them I like more than others. All of them, I think, exemplify the stuff that I'm talking about. So this is from a show called Gluteus Maximus by Loni Abrams and Johnny Stanish at the Java Project in Brooklyn. And it was up from April 10th to May 2nd, 2015. Gluteus Maximus. Here, I'm going to turn this toward me, I guess, so the people who are watching can see me read. Goals. Too far from the mic. Okay, Gluteus Maximus. Mythological muscles flex in comic book characters and gods alike. Zeus versus the Hulk in 3D. Greek sculpture was so 2013, they'll say. They'll ask, who did what? I wrote the poem or whatever that went out in the mass email. Stylized impressions, an artist's first lessons, the negative space a fist makes. Pushed against the surface. Sculpted bodies, pretty pottery girls discussing various clay bodies, high fire to last a lifetime. Decay is natural, like work and biography on the same drop-down menu. Naturally, porous. The fabric of our lives is nothing but a brand, poor us. But that's not what we're talking about here. There are layers flattened, rasterized, and soaked into fibers, stretched but not warped, hung on the wall, Gluteus Maximus, a regal sounding name for something that sits on a toilet. Hashtag deep. This is from Garden Variety by Jessica Hans and Brendan Timmons at High Tide in Philadelphia. And this show ran from January 9th to February 4th, 2016. Scarp is a lot of guessing. Quote, depending on where I start the screws, depending on where I start, the screws always end up in different places, unquote. This is the embrace of imperfection with structural stability as a control, you don't say, and then adherence to process. This collaboration is the merging of Brendan Timmons' SCARP technology with Jessica Hans' visceral ceramic experience, where the design process is instinctual and freestyle. Garden variety describes the usual, the ordinary, the commonplace, run-of-the-mill and ubiquitous. Garden variety is the uncanny valley of a flower shop presented in a context that is highly aestheticized, turning into strangeness. Hashtag deep. This is a press release for To Live and Die in the Country by these artists, a duo of artists called Body by Body, Melissa Sachs and Cameron Soren. And the press release posits 2000s Brooklyn in the throes of gentrification as a nostalgic site of white abjection through deploying a MoMA song commissioned for the show and incorporated into the press release. Ah, the trucker hat halcyon days of hipsters. Art form writer Joseph Henry, in his review of the show, describes the show and the press release as presenting a quote-unquote prelapsarian time before rapacious professionalization. To Live and Die in the Country, Body by Body, Eli Pring, Francis Perkins, June 2015. New York in the Aughts, MoMIS, 2015. Hurrah for New York in the Aughts, when Dom Z's was our tailor, and money meant nothing then, and everyone was a failure. And now the city stinks to hell of money and computers. Berlin has snatched the laurels now, the L trains for commuters. Hurrah for Brooklyn in the Aughts, seen from razor scooters, and Bushwick still a rumor. What more to say but seize the day, for fashion is soon passing, and to restore what came before, just bring back all the losers. Do you want to hear that song?
Yeah.
It's a sort of medieval Brooklyn hipster autotune ballad.
Medieval?
Yeah, it has medieval, like Gregorian chant, perfect fourths and perfect fifths, and like melismatic vocals and stuff. It's not a good song. It's got interesting stuff going on though. Who wants me to read a new poem?
You had me at the word medieval. Okay.
Should I read a new poem? Put your hands up if yes. Almost unanimous, I think. Okay.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly. He doesn't like me.
No.
It's the last thing and then I'll be done. Poetry press release for unrealized show. The show will probably be called The Last Air Dancer. So I'm going to retitle the poem right now. Poetry press release for The Last Air Dancer. Where will it happen? I don't know. When will it happen? I don't know. Will it happen? I don't know. Foucault definitely loved glory holes. His bathroom stall scribbles were always illegible. One part of governance is erotics, the erotics of boredom and anxiety. No one wants negative critique at their opening. How you fog up the mirror just to finger your name on it. This lube only works on social justice warriors. Your sneakers light up when you're racist. The constant light guides you so Europe can continue. Here in its tendrils where you stole nothing, not even nothing. You can't even imagine giving it back. Nihilists don't realize it doesn't matter that nothing matters. But I have an empathy gap toward white people. And under gender coloniality, the state itself gets latched onto the genital. Everything subsumed into holes and pricks. This American pornographic Victorianism, like those Gustinish Lee Lozano tool paintings. Closing your eyes is not the beginning of theory. Some say everyone dreams of fucking the dictator. In reality, sex is completely illegal. The only kinks are sneeze fetishes and minions. But the only way to say I love you is with fisting. A lie is not a lie. Trump's micropenis does not absolve you. Your performative divestment is escapism. I come to you with dreams of a cleaner kind of valve, a value without value, dick like bonsai. No ghost ever sold away her iPod. We let our stomachs get all full of plastic. White emo band says blood is the last ocean. Foucault rushes in, fresh out the shower, in his bathrobe like on the cover of a book, his bullet head, tweed face, my beard flushed with his kisses. Home is not only a disciplinary mechanism, he says. Would you ever order a real doll of yourself? Cool. All right, I'm done. Any other questions?
Vote. You have to have us vote.
I just did.
Wait, what?
We voted.
Yeah, we are called.
That was the vote.
I thought there was going to be another vote after that.
All right, raise your hands if you vote. Give it to the second vote.
I don't remember.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, Internet. Thank you, everyone who's here.
Sorry.
Bye.